Father God, we pray. We pray that today be a very, very special day. More than other Sundays. Touch us where we stand, Father God. We lean on you. We rely on you. We need your provision. And when you provide, we are so thankful. Thankful enough to share it. To share your provision. To share the knowledge of you with somebody else that needs you. Help us to share. Help us to become the people that you want us to be. We love you, Jesus. And we pray blessing on everybody here, but especially our moms, the women that are here, all women, every age. Thank you for placing them here. We praise you today. We honor you today. And we give you our service. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I'm going to go ahead and dismiss our children to their classes. And then also, if we have a chance, let's go ahead and say hello to one another this morning. Find somebody, shake your hand next to you, tell somebody Happy Mother's Day today. Tell them that you're glad you're here.
Good morning. If you are new, hopefully someone shook your hand this morning and said, "Welcome to Grace." My name is Sierra, and if they haven't, welcome to Grace. If you are visiting, in the seat pockets in front of you, tucked in the Bibles, we have connect cards. It's just a way for us to get to know you more than just hi on Sunday when you come in and then you leave. We would love to bring you into the family, get you involved, get you plugged in. Answer any questions that you might have of who we are and what we do here. So go ahead and fill one of those Connect cards out. You can turn it into the welcome counter. When you leave today in the lobby, the welcome center is to your right, and you turn that in, you get a little gift. Just a little way for us to say that we were so glad that you came today to see Grace and be a part of our family. Okay, so Missions Weekend, we've been talking about this. It's next week. It's just 5 short days away. We are very excited. Missions is a huge part of who we are at Grace. We support missionaries around the world and in our own communities, not too far from here. So we want to welcome you to come on Friday night, the 13th, to our missions dinner. It's at 5:30. It's always a great meal. This whole room is full of tables, and we get to hear from our missionaries near and far. You do not have to sign up to come. There's usually plenty of food. It's at 5:30, and everyone is welcome. We also have that next morning on Saturday, our men's breakfast, bright and early at 8 a.m. Also, you don't need to sign up for that. And then later that day, the ladies' tea is happening at Barbara Brusatori's home, and that starts at 11:30. Today is the last day to sign up for the tea. You can do so in the lobby as you're leaving as well. But we do need to know who's going to be coming for that. It's always lovely. The tea is one of my favorite things, not just because I could eat scones all day, every day, but that's just a highlight. Barbara Bruciatore's home is beautiful. It's also kind of unmappable. Like if you put it into your phone, it's magical, something about it. If you put her address in your phone, you will not find it. If you'd like to come, there are maps available in the back. So ladies, if you signed up for the tea, would you make a point to go back there today, pick up your ticket, pick up some information and a map so you can find Barbara's house? Also, you might want to find someone to go with because parking's a little limited. So on Saturday for the tea, remember your ticket, remember your map, remember your buddy because you're going to go together so we have enough space, and remember your sweater because she does live on a ridge. It's a little breezy. It can be a little cold, even though it says it's going to be 90. It could be a little chilly in the shade. So just remember your sweater, and there's going to be plenty of food, and we're just so excited for you guys to join us for the tea. The ladies have put so much work into that. Men's ministry, they are having their second annual trap shoot. It's going to be on Saturday, May 21st. So this next Saturday is the men's breakfast. The Saturday after that is the trap shoot dinner. It's from 4 to 7. It's here at the church. Pastor Matthew Hooper is going to be your speaker. You have smashed potatoes to eat, and it's going to be a ton of fun. It's only $10, and you can sign up with one of the men who's carrying a red clipboard. Keith Ankar's holding that up. If you want to go all swarm Keith after service, gentlemen, sign up for the trap shoot. It looks like it's going to be a ton of fun, and last year the pictures were great. They're going to have a lot of, I think Jerry said, more opportunity, more for everyone to participate. Let's see. CAC is literally 5 weeks away. What is CAC? Creative Arts Camp, VBS. It's so soon. You guys, there are so many children who are coming to this. We're thrilled. Dana still needs some help. Specifically, we need camp guides. Your role is just shuttling children here and there and making sure they get to where they're going to be and having conversation with them. How easy is that? You don't have to prepare anything. You just have to show up. We also need nursery workers for our volunteers who have small children who are too young to attend throughout the week. If you have one morning that you can work our nursery to care for the cute babies, we would love that. You can see Dana at the back at the Creative Arts Camp and sign up. If you haven't signed up, today's your day. I say it every Sunday. There is a place for you. All hands on deck for almost 300 children to be in this building. So you guys want to be here and help. You don't want to miss it. Scout Yard Sale is coming up. After Mission Sunday next week, you can begin to bring your items after next week. Everybody ready? After next week, please do not bring your kitchen table and put it in front of the office or in the storage facility, or, you know, you could put it in Pastor Mark's office if it'll fit, but definitely wait Sunday after church, the 22nd, you can begin to bring your items for the Scout Yard Sale. If you've ever attended this, it's so fun. One year I got a brand new pizza stone from Pampered Chef for $5. So you want to come. Great, great stuff. That is going to be happening the following Memorial Day weekend. So you can begin to bring your things on the 22nd, and they would love that. Talking of bringing things, we bring so much to church. We bring our time and our talents, and often we bring our tithe. So much of what we do here depends on you, from our children's ministry to youth dinners and benevolence for those who are needy in our community. All of that happens because you tithe, and I thank you so much for how often you tithe and how you do so, so, so graciously and so generously in this church. However you choose to do it, in the back, in the box, or online, or mailing a check, we thank you to do so, so humbly and do so joyfully. Happy Sunday.
Let's do a song first, and then you can come on up. Although talented enough to succeed as a professional singer, Helen Lamell sought fulfillment using her musical gifts as a form of ministry to God. It was in the year 1918, when she was 54 years old, that Helen LaMelle wrote the beautiful and challenging hymn, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. She quotes from her memoirs, "Suddenly, as if commanded to stop and listen, I stood still. And singing in my soul and spirit was the chorus, with not one conscious moment of putting word to word to make rhyme, or note to note to make melody. The verses were written in the same unusual manner, but nonetheless dictated by the Holy Spirit. It would seem that she made the words of her hymn her personal creed as she continually turned her eyes toward Jesus, serving him faithfully until the day of her death, November 1st, 1961, at the age of 96. Please stand. Your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory.
Will grow strange, leading. In the light of His glory and grace. Turn your eyes, 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 turn your eyes. All God's people said, amen. Go ahead and have a seat.
If you're able, stand. Okay. And we're going to be reading from Acts chapter 20, verses 25 through 38. And now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will ever see my face again. Therefore, I declare to you this day that I am not responsible for the blood of any of you, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole purpose of God. Keep watch over yourselves and over all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God that He obtained with the blood of His own Son. I know that after I have gone, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Some, even from your own group, will come distorting the truth in order to entice the disciples to follow them. Therefore, be alert. Remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to warn everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the message of His grace, a message that is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or clothing. You know for yourselves that I worked with my own hands to support myself and my companions. In all this I have given you an example, that by such work we must support the weak, remember the words of the Lord Jesus, for He Himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Welcome, everyone. I want to join the others in welcoming you. My name is Mark. I'm the lead pastor here at Grace, one of many sharing the responsibility of leadership here, and have the blessing of giving the word this morning. And I want to acknowledge moms. So grateful for you. Yeah. I have two moms in my life that are particularly special to me, the one that gave me birth. She usually sits in the back among the troublemaker section back there. Just teasing. And of course, the one who gives me reason for life every single day, my wife, who was one of the worshipers up here leading us and with her beautiful voice. And we are grateful. And so this morning, we are blessed to be here to open up God's Word. As you can see, a lot of us have name tags. Today is Name Tag Sunday. We try to do that occasionally to help one another. You know, you've met someone once and even twice, maybe even three times, and you've just gone beyond the part of introducing yourself again. You just can't remember your name, so I'm too embarrassed to ask again. We got your back right here. We're going to put a name tag on so we can all call each other by our names and so on. And so grateful for you that saw that table when you came in and put that name tag on. And lastly, before we jump into the Word, I want to give you one heads up. Next Sunday, we've talked about that being our missions conference weekend. Sunday itself, I just want to alert you that we're going to be taking a special collection that day for our featured missionaries. So in addition to the normal giving that you're so faithful to do, supporting the ministries at Grace, we're going to actually pass the plate on Sunday, make a special collection for our featured missionaries to give them a gift. For their travels and expenses. We pay for their expenses, but to give them something beyond that to be here next Sunday. So just be prepared for that when that plate comes around so you have a heads up between now and then. So we are finishing up this section of Acts. We've been in the book of Acts for lots of weeks, months, and we're so grateful for that. Here at Grace, we go through books of the Bible verse by verse, and occasionally we'll stop and do a series or something, but primarily we go through verse by verse because we feel like that is I'd be careful how I word this. I don't want to say we're something better than anybody else, but it's safe just to teach God's word, and you don't miss things, or you're not in danger of just preaching your pet doctrines and whatever. And so, and you're forced too to learn things that you probably wouldn't have studied otherwise. So we're grateful for that as we open up the book of Acts. Thank you, Nancy, for reading our passage today. Because we're continuing this is going to be the second half of an address that Paul makes to the elders from Ephesus. So remember, Paul is on his farewell tour. That's the PFT up there, if you're just curious about that. Paul's farewell tour. So he's on the last leg of his third missionary journey. He's collecting funds for the poor in Jerusalem. He's on his way back there, and he's stopping at specific locations to encourage the churches, collect those funds, and deliver them to Jerusalem. And here he is his ship has docked near Ephesus. He calls to the elders to come while the ship is being unloaded of its cargo, reloaded for the next journey, and they're going to head all the way down eventually to Caesarea, where he'll get off and head on by land to Jerusalem. And he calls for the elders of Ephesus. He brings them together, and here's his final words, his farewell address to them. And anytime you think this is maybe the last time we see each other, you really pick your words carefully. And so it's been a pleasure to kind of slow down and examine the things that Paul is saying. We took last week to cover the first part of this farewell address, and this week we'll finish that up, beginning with verse 25. So one of the things I want to draw attention to in this part of what Paul says is the idea of the kingdom of God, which he also equates to the whole counsel of God. Let's read those verses together as a way of a reminder. In verse 25, he says, "And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom," there's our word kingdom, that's why I make that reference, "will see my face again." This might be the last time we see each other. Verse 26, "Therefore I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all of you, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God." If I'm going to walk away from a group of people, this is a great confidence that Paul says. There was nothing. He's already said it earlier in his address when he says, there was nothing of value that I did not tell you. I mean, I told you all the good stuff, everything you need to know. And he says, I've told you the whole counsel of God, which in his mind is equating to the idea of the kingdom of God. So what is Paul talking about? Just by way of reminder for each of us, three primary aspects of the message of the whole counsel of God or the kingdom of God is, one, as you can imagine, the gospel. What we consider the gospel has to do with salvation. Salvation through faith, specifically faith in Jesus, in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Christ died for our sins. We cannot be saved unless we understand our sin separates us from God. And God, who loves us, who is a just God, he himself provided the provision for our sin, that debt to be paid. And through faith, the very righteousness of God is credited to our account. We see this in his first letter to Corinthians, which Paul's already written by this time. He wrote it on this very missionary journey. He says this to them by way of reminder, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures." So we see the kingdom of God, the gospel message, begins with salvation through faith. But that's not where it ends. The gospel really spans quite a bit of information. Secondarily, and probably what most of the New Testament dwells on, is that we would live a life reflective of that gospel, that we'd walk in a manner worthy of Jesus or walk in the works God has ordained for us. So Paul, in his letter to this church, the Ephesians, reminds them about this salvation. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not of your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. However, he does not stop here, because works are important. Life transformation is important. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And in fact, in chapter 4 of Ephesians, he begins, I, Paul, as a prisoner of Christ, urge you to walk or to live in a manner worthy of Jesus Christ. In fact, how Paul structures most of his letters, his epistles to churches, he begins with the explanation of what you should believe, or sound doctrine about God, about Jesus, about the Holy Spirit. And then usually the second half of his letter is dedicated to walking or living in a manner worthy of God. What does that look like? How does it look like in our workplace? How does that look like in our homes with our husbands or wives or our children? Wherever we are, whether in word or deed, we do all things for the glory of God. That's a lot of what we talk about at church when we gather. And thirdly, we long for Christ's return. We look for it. As a matter of a essential doctrine of our faith is waiting, longing for Christ's return. One of the early letters he wrote, Paul wrote this on his second missionary journey, is to the Thessalonians. And he says this several times in their book. In fact, every chapter in 1 Thessalonians ends with some sort of encouragement about the return of Christ. This is the end of chapter 1 when it says, they themselves, or those who see the lives of the Thessalonians, the believers, they themselves report how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. And so the end of, you know, the culmination of the kingdom is that God will return. Jesus will return to earth. He will judge the nations and he will set up his kingdom, and we will join him in that endeavor, and we'll live with Christ forever from that point. This is the kingdom of God, the whole counsel of God, not just salvation by faith, but it's our entire lives dedicated to God and longing for that one day where we'll see Christ face to face when he makes all wrongs right. He'll reward the righteous. He'll rescue us from this world, and he will judge the wicked. That is the whole message. So this is Paul said, man, I haven't failed to give you the whole story. I've told you it all. I'm free. I'm innocent of your blood. Whatever you choose to do from this point on, it's on your own head. It's not on mine. I gave you the full message. This is how Paul begins this section. So now, remember, he's addressing the leadership, the elders of that Ephesian church. So the rest of his farewell address really kind of points out what you should be paying attention to. These are your priorities, he says to them. You're about to go back to that local congregation and expand on everything that I told you. You're going to go back and you're going to guard them. You're going to teach them and nurture the growth of their faith, their salvation. So the rest of the passage, he talks about their priorities. So let's begin, first of all, with the importance of self-leadership. Look at verse 28, just the first line, the first part of it says, to the elders, he says, pay careful attention to yourselves. Self-leadership. If you're going to be in a position of responsibility, which they were, you have to watch your own life and doctrine carefully. You have to lead by example. So remember, I talked about the church in Ephesus being probably the church we know most about in the New Testament. We have more things written to this church than any other church in the New Testament. So you have Paul visiting them in Acts. Here we have a farewell address to them. We have a letter that Paul writes during his first Roman imprisonment, the letter to the Ephesians. After that imprisonment, he sends letters to Timothy, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy. Timothy is in Ephesus. He is furthering the work of God, setting up more structure in that church as that church grows and matures. And finally, the very last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus himself, when he is addressing John, who is, this is the very end of the first century, John is in exile, and Jesus appears to him, gives him a revelation of the end of all things. In that revelation, he addresses the Ephesian church. So drawing from this, it's important. We kind of gather some additional information other than what we've already read in Acts. So pulling from that, we'll go to 1 Timothy, who is serving in leadership in Ephesus as he is continuing to nurture and establish leadership there. He says, "Let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. Practice these things. Immerse yourselves in them so that all may see your progress." In other words, Timothy, as an example, watch your life and your doctrine carefully. Be sure to make sure you are leading yourself first before you attempt to lead others, that you're submitting your life to the Lord, that you're studying diligently the Scriptures, that you're aligning your life to those Scriptures, that anybody who sees you, they see that you how that your sincerity of your faith. So not only it's about teaching for these leaders, sound doctrine, that's really important, but their very lives are to be seen before all, and they can see that you're growing. They can see if something happens to you, somebody, you know, the enemies come in, the fierce wolves that we're going to talk about in a second, or a life circumstance that really starts rocking your boat and unsettles your life. How do you respond? We must, in leadership, Paul is exhorting those elders, watch your life closely. How are you living it out through the ups and downs of life? Is your life one of faith and a sound doctrine? So in addition to the importance of self-leadership, just the very opening part of that verse, we go to the second half of that verse, and we see that he says, also pay careful attention to the flock. And he goes on to give some weight to that exhortation to them. He says, pay careful to your attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. God died, shed his blood for the church. What a weight of responsibility for those in whom he has placed the local church's care, the leadership. We have responsibility to feed, to nurture, to protect. And Paul is, first of all, admonishing those leaders, watch your life, and then protect the flock. God cares. God sees. He purchased this local church with his own blood. That's how much God thinks, that this blood that is beyond the value of gold or silver. Nothing can be compared. That's the church. So pay attention, not only to yourselves, but to the flock. So he's going to go on to warn them about some of these coming problems that he foresees. So look at verse 29. It says, I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. I myself, Paul says, set you the example of warning in addition to teaching and encouragement and living my life. I also protected and warned for the 3 years of my ministry since you've known me. And he says, these wolves are going to come from in your midst. I think it's easy for us to think about those ideas of the world or leaders that might, you know, or influencers that might draw you away from God. But these people, Paul says, it's going to actually happen within your congregation. People that you trust. And it's hard for me to admit that the reality is that we see this over and over and over again, not just in the life of God's people throughout the centuries, but very likely you have experienced deep wounding from a trusted church leader at some point in your life, many of you already. And the fact that you're here, praise God, you're trusting in Jesus, you're working through that wound, and you're learning to set your eyes on Christ rather than on a particular leader who you entrusted but then let you down or wounded you in some way. I myself can attest that some of my deepest wounds in my life that I've had to work through and how do I forgive? How do we reconcile? How does this even work? And just dealing with anger and injustice, those wounds have come from trusted leaders within the church. Beginning when I was in youth group. And this is a sad reality. Paul warns of this. You have to guard yourself against those who would cause harm. That's a sad part of the commentary of the church. And we need to continue to uphold one another in prayer and to acknowledge these wounds and speak words of comfort, encouragement. And if you are healing here today, because perhaps a wound or something, some of these things I'm about to bring up kind of trigger something in you, know that God loves you. He's already said to these elders, I have shed my own blood for this church. Do not fail in protecting them. Somebody has failed you. Maybe I have failed you in some way. Jesus will never fail us. Keep our eyes on Jesus. So because we know so much about the Ephesian church, segue. There are at least four of these threats, these wolves that had come into their midst that I think is observable even to us today in our own. And I'm going to list these for you. Number one, there's a threat of legalism that it would enter into their midst. We can document. We'll go there in a moment. Number two, the threat of false doctrine. We see that everywhere, but it happened in the Ephesian church. Number three, the threat of secondary issues. People making big deals out about lesser things and dividing the church over it. That happens in Ephesus. And lastly, the threat of intellectualism. I'll explain what I mean by that in a moment, that Jesus himself addresses in the church of Ephesus. So the very first idea is this threat of legalism. What I mean by this is the most common threat to all the New Testament church, not just in Ephesus, is this wall of hostility that existed between Jews and Gentiles. It was very difficult, particularly for the Jews in Jerusalem, to accept the idea that God would accept Gentiles, people who were not born Jew, apart from being a part of the Jewish community, or to also place their faith and observe Jewish rituals and rites and so on. And Paul's ministry was largely to the Gentiles. He always went to the Jews first, but they often would reject his message, and then he would turn to the Gentiles. And the Gentiles, by the thousand, were coming to faith in Jesus apart from any adherence to Judaistic rituals and principles. Well, this would cause division. And Jews from Jerusalem, who were also believers in Jesus, often sent out their own missionaries to go to these churches to learn them up about the fact that, you know, it's great that you placed your faith in Jesus, but you really, you know, if you really want to honor God, you also have to observe certain rituals, like circumcision, for instance. And so much of Paul's ministry was convincing Jews that that's not true and convincing Gentiles that you don't have to do that. Paul himself observed Judaism. He continued to worship on the Sabbath. I'm convinced. We see evidence of him taking vows. We've already seen it once in Acts. We're going to see it again in weeks to come. You know, he himself is a devout Jew. He still holds, you know, I'm sure he is ascribing to much of the dietary laws, and he's trying to get back to Jerusalem in time to celebrate Pentecost. I mean, he's still very much a Jew, but he doesn't place those same rituals, he never places them on Gentiles. No, you don't have to do that. For me, it has great meaning. For you, it doesn't. You don't have any background in that. Just focus on Jesus. And so oftentimes, in almost every letter that he addresses to a church, he has to address this idea that if you're not already a part of Israel, understand that you are a part of Israel through your faith, the very same faith that Abraham expressed in God before he was even circumcised. He says that in the book of Galatians. So I'll just turn to Ephesians to give you an example of it. If you turn with me, there's pew Bibles there around you, a few of them if you want, if you don't have your own today. I'm just going to turn to Ephesians real quick and take a look at a couple of these ideas. Ephesians chapter 1, Paul starts with, again, rooting them in their faith, that it is by faith in Jesus alone. He says in verse 3 about all the blessings they have in Jesus. Remember, the Ephesian church is primarily Gentile, though it consists of both Jews and Gentiles. It's primarily Gentile. So he says this in chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. So there's not any he leaves out. Paul's really careful at reminding of them, and he goes on to talk about they received the adoption as sons, therefore they have an inheritance, they've been given the Holy Spirit, all of these evidences of God's approval of them apart from becoming Jewish. He would go on to remind them, we've already read this verse in our opening statements in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, he says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not of your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. He would go on to say, addressing this idea of those who are call themselves the circumcision, that's Jews, who call Gentiles uncircumcised, by way, that's it's not a good word. They want to say it as a derision. That's the one I'm thinking of. It's like, yeah, those uncircumcised, it's like, yeah, let's talk about that. Verse 11 in chapter 2, he says, therefore, remember at one time you Gentiles in the flesh called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, the Jews, which is made in flesh by hands. Remember, he says, he goes on, I'll get to the crux of this. You were without hope in God in the world, verse 13, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances like circumcision, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace. And he'll go on, say it in several different ways. Look at chapter 3. I'll just read one more verse here. Chapter 3, verse 6. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. So the first threat that would come their way is the same threat every New Testament church faced. And why Paul himself was constantly beaten in prison, plots about his death, was at the hand of these Judaizers, Jews, who were trying to stop Paul's message. Paul worked hard to try to reconcile Jewish believers and Gentile believers. And there would be this threat of legalism in their midst. Secondly, we see the threat of false doctrine. You don't have to turn there. I'll have it up on the screen here, this idea. Again, Paul is writing Timothy, who is in Ephesus. He says this in his second letter, likely during his second Roman imprisonment. That's the one he would be killed at the end of that. In chapter 4, verse 1, it says, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort, with complete patience and teaching. In other words, teach sound doctrine. Make sure you're watching yourself and your doctrine closely. For he goes on, for the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions. And we'll turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. So not only is there going to be Jews that try to make create controversy through legalistic righteousness becoming Jews, but there's going to be just false doctrine. And people are going to receive it because it appeals to their own passions. Third, the threat of secondary issues. So we have threat of legalism, threat of false doctrine, and thirdly, the threat of secondary issues. These are the issues that are important, but not as important as the essential issues. There's a quote that you may have heard, which says this: in essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; in all things, charity. Now, when I first heard this quote lots of years ago, somebody said, oh, that's Athanasius, who I'm thinking of, one of our great church leaders of the later centuries. Augustine. There he goes. It's in my head. But it's actually not him. It was this fellow that his name is, I'll attempt to pronounce it, Rupertus Maldenius. To say that slowly. What does he mean by this? Because it's always going to be a threat. So he's writing this early 17th century. So still these secondary issues becoming divisive in the church. He says, in essentials, unity. What do we mean by essentials? What do we believe about God? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Each of these are three members, three persons of the Holy Spirit. We would call the Trinity. This would be a central doctrine of Christianity, that we believe that Jesus himself is God. Holy Spirit, he is God. These are essential parts of what the Bible teaches, that salvation is by faith alone in Christ alone. Essential doctrines of Scripture. I would say one of the doctrines that is pretty way up there is that we believe that the Bible itself is our final authority for all faith and practice. This is our appeal book, and that it is inspired by God himself, not just written by men, and it is inerrant in its original documents, right? When those apostles were originally writing down the words, it was recorded without error, exactly how God wants us to understand himself. These are essential truths of our faith that we build our faith on. But there are also secondary issues that are important. They're important to talk about, but we may not always agree about those issues. They're not salvation issues. For example, what do we believe about how all things are going to end? When we're talking about prophecy, especially end time prophecy, any prophecy really, until it's happened, it's kind of uses language that is a largely metaphorical, and it's pointing to different symbols, and what do those symbols mean, and what fulfillment could they have? And we see in the Old Testament a lot of the prophecies that have already been fulfilled. We see, oh yeah, it's so clear. This prophecy is preaching Christ. This is a prophecy that's leading to his birth or to his death. And we can point from one point to another point, Old Testament, New Testament, we see exactly how it's fulfilled. But those living in the first century would not have necessarily applied all of those prophecies to Jesus. Many of them missed it. Even the disciples themselves missed many of the prophecies because of the language is used. And Jesus himself would explain to them between his resurrection and his ascension a lot of these prophecies that these apostles later would explain to the church. However, there are many prophecies yet to be fulfilled. And that's one of the great things about our 9 a.m. hour and teaching very practical things about how to live your life. Dan Conley is leading a class at our 9 a.m. hour on our family values and what does the Bible teach about this? Are we successful as a family and relationship and so on? And one of our elders, Steve Pera, is teaching on end time prophecies at 9 a.m. to give us a framework of, there's more than one way to look at these prophecies, and he's given us a framework to help us navigate some of those issues. Now, a secondary issue is how, in what kind of detail is all of that going to happen? An essential issue, not secondary, is the reality that Jesus is going to return. Everybody agrees about that who is a part of the Orthodox Christian faith. Okay, I thought I advanced the slide. So that is an essential issue. We have to believe as a part of the kingdom of God, about the whole counsel of God, that Jesus will return. One day, we will all face judgment. It's a part and compels us to tell people about Jesus, right? We love people. We don't want them to end in eternity apart from God. One day Christ will return. He will judge. If our life ends on this earth, the Bible tells us clearly that there is no second chance. We will face judgment. And so these are essential issues. But how it all comes about after we die or when Christ returns, we have a lot of information, but we don't necessarily have to agree with every single point. That's a secondary issue. So in essentials, unity. Salvation, we believe about God. Christ is going to return. Non-essentials, we have liberty. In other words, I can hear your argument. We open up the Bible together, and as Christian brothers and sisters, we can talk about our viewpoints that don't necessarily have to agree. But in those things that we may disagree about, we must act and respond toward one another in charity, in love, taking a posture of seeking to understand rather than just to prove my point. Steve and Sierra and Martha and I attended a conference up in Idaho a few weeks ago, and one of the last sessions was a debate between two experts in the idea of what hell is and what hell is going to, the experience of hell is going to be like for those who have not placed their faith in Jesus Christ. And so that's one of those doctrines that there is more than one view. So can we have a debate and still act in love to one another? And I've never been a part of a debate that wasn't similar to like in politics when we see those kind of debates. It's less about policy and more about just making the other person look stupid. In this case, they're passionately presenting two different views about hell, which is hell itself is an essential part of our doctrine, right? So what do we actually believe about it? The details of it, a little less able to discern all of the details of it. And they're having this great debate, but they're even throwing little pot shots at each other, but they're laughing about it. And they keep telling us, you guys, we debate all the time. We're actually friends, even though in scholarly circles we had two different viewpoints. We love one another. We're brothers in Christ. And some of the pot shots they'd throw at each other were actually in jest, and they made us all laugh, though we were all uncomfortable sometimes because they were holding really strongly two different views. What a great example of how to engage someone else who doesn't believe the same thing you do, though some holds maybe some of the same values, yet still act in love. Paul said, this is one of the things that will divide the church that you have to warn against, is making a secondary issue such a big deal that it's a point of division. We see this also in Ephesus. Paul writes to Timothy, as I urged you when I was going to Macedonia, remain at Ephesus so that you may charge certain persons in the church not to teach in a different doctrine, nor to devote themselves to myths or endless genealogies, which promote speculations rather than stewardship from God that is by faith. So he's making the differentiation. Those are secondary issues. You're speculating about it. You don't know exactly, okay, we could have more than one view here. He would go on to say in that same chapter, certain persons, he's talking about very specific people. He's going to name them. I won't name them today. But he says, certain persons have wandered away into vain discussion, desiring to be teachers. So their motive was to be somebody important, to have some sort of influence in the church. Teachers of the law without understanding, That's what they didn't know what they were talking about. Either that they were either what they were saying or the things about which they make these confident assertions on secondary issues about genealogies and Jewish myths. He wraps up in the last chapter of this same book. He says he, talking about the one or the kind of person who is doing these things, is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words which produce envy, dissension, slander, evil suspicions, these speculative things. So Paul is warning against those, even in our midst, who would, first of all, promote legalism. Second of all, would promote some doctrine other than the sound, essential doctrine of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And thirdly, promote these secondary issues as points of division, and it sounds like to gather a following for themselves and then divide the church over. Which leads us to a commendation from Jesus. Remember, Jesus appears to John in Revelation, our very last book of the Bible, and he says this about the church in Ephesus. How'd they do when these kind of people were in their midst? Jesus says, these are Jesus' words about the church in Ephesus, way at the end of the first century. I know your works, your toil, your patient endurance, how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. So they passed the test. They did great. They adhered to the word of God. Those false teachers came in, and they said, "No, you're not the real deal. We're going to follow the word of God." Even received a commendation from Jesus, which leads us to our fourth threat, the threat of intellectualism. And this is a little less subtle. I left it as the fourth one. And really, this is the idea that Jesus, even after he gives them this commendation for upholding sound doctrine and calling out false apostles, he says this, "I have this one thing against you," the very next verse here in Revelation, "that you have abandoned the love you had at first." And I'm reading between the lines a little bit here, so this is speculative from my vantage point. Based upon my own experience, in that sometimes we can be in danger of upholding the teachings of Scripture and sound doctrine on such a high level that we believe we have to simultaneously downplay human experience, relationship with Jesus, where our heart is, and the emotions that are attached with that. That is an unnecessary dichotomy. We at Grace, if you've attended here for any length of time, you know that we uphold sound doctrine, that we are very careful at discerning and understanding the Word of God and teaching it week in, week out. But what can happen is that becomes our God. And we lose touch with our heart and the very emotions God has given us and our very experiences in prayer, in worship, in life that point us to a heart-forward relationship with Jesus Christ. I love how God has led me personally more recently into expanding and being in touch with my own heart, in addition to the hours and hours and hours I spend studying the Word of God to be able to teach it accurately. And if you haven't picked up a recent article or our newsletter, my lead article talks about that, how God draws us to himself through our senses, our sight, our smell, our hearing, our taste, our touch. God designed these things for us for our pleasure, but to woo us to him, to understand that he wants us to experience life through all of our senses while being guided by sound doctrine. I mean, I think about, there's a reason. When we're worshiping God with music, how music moves us. This is by design by God himself to take sound words that we're singing and put them to music that stirs us on an emotional level. This is by God's design. It's not, you know, it's not a bad thing at all. I love the fact that those who prepare our slides when we're worshiping God and we're seeing, we could just have a blank screen. You know, mine's pretty dull up here, just a lot of words and so on. But when we're worshiping God, I love how both Janisa and Wendy, who prepare our slides, and Jonathan did this week, right? How they tried, they work really hard to present images that also evoke in us a response emotionally of our senses. They try to produce images that are beautiful, that are evoking, and all, but they won't distract necessarily from the words themselves. They're always, they take their jobs really seriously, selecting these photos and so on to help draw us emotionally without distracting us from the content of what we're singing. This is what we're trying to accomplish when we say we are balancing between sound doctrine and holding a very high view of Scripture, but not neglecting the heart, engaging our heart in relationship with God, with one another, with the world around us, understanding our life with all of our senses as God's design for us to have pleasure in our relationship with Him. I'll finish what Jesus said here. I had this one thing against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent, and do the works you did at first. Oftentimes, our relationship with God in the initial days, months, years are so exciting. From my own experience, I just sought God, often with tears. I'm a journaler. I've journaled from the time I was in high school, always penning what my heart felt. But I grew as I was wounded in church, coming kind of full circle to the beginning, to downplay my heart, because engaging my heart at that level just hurt too much. It cost too much. It was risking too much because I couldn't trust what was actually going to happen to me while I'm in the church. And so I moved toward intellectualism. It was my salvation for a time. It was my way out of such a dark place. But I went back to Bible college. I went to seminary to learn the original languages, to go so deep. And all of that was so good for me, so profitable. But at the same time, this is the wrong part. I was simultaneously closing down my heart in self-preservation, protection. To the point that if I would go back and read journals, and I do this with some regularity. A couple years ago, I was going back to read an occurrence I knew happened in my life a number of years ago that was really deeply affecting me. It affected me at such a heart level, so painful part of my life. And I would go back and I would read my journal entries through that period of time. Profoundly affected my life. And I was shocked to read journal entry after journal entry after journal entry without a single mention of that most profound event that was happening to me. I'm like, what? I know what was happening to you during that time. I have dates at the head of each of these things I'm journaling about, but all I'm journaling about is the Word of God, what God is teaching me, and much of it is a very academic sense. I'm not engaging my heart. In my experience, is because of a wound. It was self-preservation. And intellectualism, for me, it was my way of getting out of the dark place in my life. I'm so grateful that God has led me back. I'm experiencing afresh the wonder of all that God wants for us. So a threat I speculatively offer is that it could be a threat of intellectualism. Let's finish up our passage. So Paul moves now in verse 32 to blessing these elders. He says, "And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified." What a rich blessing he gives. I approve of you. I affirm you. God himself affirms you, approves. You have this inheritance because of the work you're doing. And he gives us this additional encouragement at the end here. He encourages their hard work. Look at verse 33. He uses himself as an example. He says, "I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things, I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, it is more blessed to give and to receive. So what is Paul saying? He has given them this, first of all, this principle, it is blessed, more blessed to give than to receive. Why? We know Paul's life, he didn't ask them, never asked the church directly for money for himself. He worked. That was his philosophy. But that wasn't the philosophy of all the apostles, nor the idea that he would want to perpetuate on every single church after him. He said, that was my personal philosophy. And so you know my life, and you know the blessing it is to give of yourself freely without asking for money, to do so on a voluntary basis. And the thing I want to draw attention to here is most of leadership in the local church is voluntary. I want to pass this blessing on to you who serve faithfully, prepare to teach, to serve in all the various capacities of the needs of this fellowship, our finances, our teaching our children, those who greet at the door, those who are running sound and live stream, leading worship, in all the various ways, both up front and behind the scenes. God sees. He sees and he wants to bless you. It is more blessed to give than to receive. You receive a special blessing from God because of your voluntary service. But as the church grows and the responsibility of leadership increases, it's also a principle Paul would later give to the church that the laborer deserves his wages. So at this point, it looks like that the elders of the church weren't receiving any compensation for the work that they were doing. He says, hey, God sees, he blesses you. But as the church grows, Paul sends Timothy again. Later on in 1 Timothy, he says this about them. Let the elders, this is to Timothy to pass on to the church in Ephesus. Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages. So as the local church grew, so did the necessity of the leadership to spend an extreme amount of time. They couldn't. It was hard, so hard to work, supply the needs for their family, and give all the attention that was necessary in their leadership roles. They had the accelerated roles. So as they naturally expand, so Paul said, yeah, well, of course, you need all that. You need to be compensated for that. It's okay. It's biblical. You don't always have to be in a voluntary role. And so we, even at Grace here, my living is based upon your commitment, your support financially, as is other accelerated roles here at Grace. We have our office manager that is on staff. We have Sierra Para, who's our ministry director. We have Jonathan, who's our worship leader. We have Dana, who is our children's ministry director. And so thank you. Thank you that we get to, you know, either part-time or full-time, have, you know, a little bit of help so we can dedicate more time to the responsibilities of a growing congregation. Thank you for that. It is so freeing, so good. And Paul acknowledges the blessing both of volunteer leadership, which is by far the majority of what happens in the local church, and those individuals with accelerated responsibilities who are receiving this double honor of also having some compensation for that. It's such a blessing, and we are so very grateful to you for that. More blessed to give than receive, the labor deserves his wages. And finally, and as I read this, I'm going to have the worship team come up. We're going to get ready to sing our last song together. I just want to read this last passage as Luke gives his epitaph at the very end. And when he had said these things, Paul, his farewell address, he knelt down and prayed with them all. And there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and kissed him, being sorrowful most of all because the word he had spoken, that they would not see his face again. And they accompanied him to the ship. Now, if I were Paul Harvey, I would tell you the rest of the story is that Paul would see them again. Some years later, that's what he implies in his first letter to Timothy. He's already visited Ephesus again, and he's on his way to Macedonia. And so that's the good news. And as we finish our service today, we're going to come full circle. The song we're going to sing is one of the great hymns of our faith that draws upon the essentials of the Christian faith, the kingdom of God, where our salvation lies, and our hope of the return of Jesus Christ. It's an ancient hymn that some modern songwriters have kind of adapted into a more modern praise song. And hopefully you'll recognize both the old hymn and the new song as we sing it together. Let's stand again as we sing this song in our closing worship to the Lord.
Built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And then I trust the sweetest frame and wholly trust Jesus' name.
Time together by reading the doxology in the book of Ephesians. Paul writes this as our closing statement here today. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than we can ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen. Happy Mother's Day. Go in peace today.